Hello everyone. Just wait for the rest of us to join in and then we'll start. Hi Rohit.
Hello.
Hello. I expect Shashwat to join as well, because he did specifically mention to me that he was looking for this time series forecasting study. So I think he's just joining in. Let me admit him. Hello, Shashwat, can you hear us? Not sure if you can hear us because I don't see the mic option there. Not sure why. So let me just try to chat. Rohi, I hope you can hear us, right?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay. So let me quickly ask him to rejoin. Then, oh, great. Hi, Shashwat. I hope you can hear us. Great. Okay. Then, great. Okay, fine. So, let's give it a start then. So, what I'm going to do, let me share my screen. Can I confirm one friends that you are able to see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, good. So let's start with the basics of time series. So what we are going to do today is that we're going to look into a new, completely new aspect, and that is known as forecasting. So forecasting is basically a chapter by itself. Forecasting is basically a field of study by itself. So we'll try to make this as comprehensive as we can, because unfortunately, there are actually many aspects related to the time series analysis that we would need to know. Unfortunately, it's not going to complete the subject. So what I intend to do, right, what I intend to do is that I'll start with the basics of time series. Okay, so I'll start with the basics of time series. I'll share all the information that I have, or all the knowledge, all the information that I have, basis my experience, post which we can go into the case studies or the implementations, in which we will look into some very, basic things that we can do in Python, right? And then I'm also going to show you a library, which is called FBProfit. Okay, so FBProfit is a really nice library. I really like that. Although in our organization, we are not using this into production. Whatever we use into production is either using Python or even more using R, because R is really very good when it comes to time series analysis. So along with Python, we also do use R, right? Now, it will go in this way, that at least for the first 2 to 3 sessions, right? I'll take at least 2 to 3 sessions to do the explanations, do the backgrounds, and then we are going to go into the hands-on. So if you have any questions, I would strongly recommend that you should be raising that right now. Yeah. So let's try to start it then. Give me 1 minute. Let me just zoom out a little bit. So let's try to define what we are going to do in this session. What we are going to do in this session is that we are going to do something which is otherwise known as forecasting. Okay. So we are going to do something which is otherwise known as forecasting. So what is really forecasting? If we are able to define this, then we'll come to know, right, as to what all are the components that we really need when it comes to forecasting, right? I hope you are able to see my screen, right? You are able to see see the whiteboard? If I can get a confirmation once.
Yes.
Okay. So why we need to do, or the definition related to forecasting is that, can I try to estimate? Okay. Can I try to estimate a value in future? Okay, can I try to estimate a value in future? And objective number two is, by doing so, okay, by doing so, can I be prepared? Okay, so these are the two important points, I would say, the most important reasons why I would like to do time series analysis. Because if you look at, or I would like to do forecasting, because if you look at point number one, it's quite clear that I'm trying to estimate a value. Okay, I'm trying to estimate a value in future. Now, you're already aware that estimation of a value is, this is something that we have already done in case of regression, for example, right? We were able to estimate a value, right? We were able to estimate a value for the future, right? This is something that we have already done. Then why do we need forecasting if we already have the regression analysis? Now, one thing that I would like to very clearly tell you is that regression, okay, is actually one of the ways in which we can do forecasting. So regression is also used, I'm going to say, regression is also used to perform forecasting, okay? But there are a certain areas where there are actually simpler ways to do the forecasting. Because if you remember what we were doing in case of, let's say, forecasting is that, or what we were doing in case of, let's say, regression is that we were creating our final function to define or to estimate the value of y. We were defining a function, let's say something which is f of capital X, okay, where capital X is the, is, let's say, the set of features, right? And what we are trying to do is that we were trying to find something which is something like this, b0 x0 plus beta 1 x1 plus b2 x2 plus until and unless bn xn, where, okay, where the set of B0, B1, B2, right? These are nothing but the coefficients. Okay, these are nothing but the coefficients. Where you can also say that B0 is basically the intercept. Okay, you can also say B0 is the intercept. And B1, B2, everything becomes the slopes, right? And these variables, X set of features which I have, this is defined as what? A set of values which is given by x1, x2 until xfn, right? This is given by this, and this is b1, b2 until bfn. So we were already doing the regression analysis where I could really model my outcome data using a function like this. Then comes the question, why cannot I do forecasting using regression, right? Because there is one more aspect here. Okay, there is one more aspect here. Now this aspect is known as the preparation aspect, okay? Preparation aspect is really very important. We often ignore this, but we really should not, because this is the crux, I would say, why you do any kind of, let's say, forecasting estimates. Okay. So overall, what I can say, I can clearly say that there are two ways. Okay. There are two ways, or there are two methods in which, two methods in which I can do the forecasting activities. So one method is going to be regression. Okay, so I can clearly do forecasting using regression. And the other method, I'm going to keep them under the data mining techniques. Okay, I'm going to put them inside the data mining techniques. And what we are going to do in case of these data mining techniques also, although this definition is still really a challenge, that we're going to find out and apply statistically significant methods. Okay, that's all we are going to do. Statistically significant methods we are going to apply, okay, to find or formulate, okay, the patterns. Okay, that's all we are going to do. Once we are able to use some statistical methods to find or to formulate the pattern which is there in the data, then we will be able to do forecasting. This is what we are going to learn. And one of the ways in which we are going to do that is known as time series. Or this forecasting word is very, very closely related to this terminology known as time series, right? So that is what we are trying to learn over here, right? So what we are going to do is that, or you can say this is just another method, Okay, I can also say this is just another method, or this is just another way to do forecasting. Right? But this time series falls under the data mining aspect. Okay, data mining is where time series falls in. Okay, we are going to categorize time series in form of or in place of the data mining areas. So what we are going to do in here, right? What we are going to do in here is that I would like to take some data which has already happened. Okay, and I would like to use that to find out what may happen. In other words, let me just scroll down, and don't worry, I'm going to share these notes as images also. So don't worry right now, you will be getting the notes. You don't have to look at the recording once more. So our objective in each and every machine learning problem, we have defined our objective function. Right? So let's try to define what is going to be our overall objective here. So overall objective when it comes to, let's say, forecasting. Okay, I'm not going to go into time series right now. I'm just going to look into forecasting. Overall, when it comes to forecasting, what I'm going to do, my objective is going to be number one, okay, look into a considerable, okay, considerable amount, okay, of history. Now, this is really important. Okay, this is really, really very important. This is something that people often ignore. Okay, this is something which people really don't take seriously. Please don't do that mistake. Okay, I'm being very, very honest with you. Please don't take this statement that I've just given you very seriously. Okay, the statement is really serious. This is not to be joked about. If we are going to do time series, we need good data. Or in other words, we are going to need a good amount of data. We have seen this in case of, let's say, machine learning also, right? We have seen this in case of, let's say, machine learning applications also, that obviously we need a very good amount of data to do the relevant machine learning modeling things, right? In this case also, we will need considerable amount of data. I'm really sorry to tell you, but it is going to take. If you don't have considerable amount of data, for those cases, let me put a star, and I'm going to come back to them when we start looking into deep learning. Okay? When we start learning about deep learning, then I'll come back to that asterisk. I'm not going to talk about it right now. Ideally, deep learning requires even more data than any data mining techniques. But as of date, deep learning has evolved to such an extent, and we will learn about them when we go in there, that even with non-considerable amount of historical data also, I may still be able to do some amount of, let's say, forecasting. So that is objective number one. Objective number two, if not more, okay, estimate, okay, at least some part, some future, right? Some part in the future. This is also very important. Usually what is going to happen, and at a later stage, you are going to find this out really interesting, or sometimes even really non-interesting or non-profound, is that when you do some kind of a time series analysis, just try to imagine that this is your historical data, some kind of historical data you have, and the kind of predictions that you have got, unfortunately, is only this. So what I mean by that is, if you look at this very, very carefully, and I'm going to explain this graph now, that is the reason why I drew this graph also. I'm going to draw three straight lines over here. Okay, I have something on the x-axis, I have something on the y-axis, which I'm going to define now. And then I have just drawn these three straight lines where I'm going to mark them, these points as x1, x2, and x3. So x1 until x2, this range of data, you can call this range. I'm obviously going to define x, you will come to know what is x. This range is what I can call the training data. Okay, this is range is what I can call the training data. And this training data refers to what point number one. Okay, this is the data from where we learn the patterns. Okay, this is from where we are going to learn the pattern. So this is going to be my training data, similar to the kind of training data that I've seen in case of, let's say, machine learning also. And this part over here, this range over here, x1, x2 to x3, this delta, okay, this small part, okay, this small part over here, this gap over here, this gap is unfortunately the prediction. Okay, or the estimation. Okay, unfortunately, that is the case. This is something that we have to deal with. I'm going to tell you some of my practical experiences as to how to deal with such a situation, especially when you are standing in front of clients, because this is very, very hard to explain or justify. Okay. Please hold on to your thoughts on this point. We will come back to it. Once you understand what these axes means, you will yourself come to know what the problem here is, right? But this is a reality. This is actually a reality. We will only be able to estimate this much that I have drawn in this violet color, provided we have been given data, provided we have trained ourselves with the data which you see in this yellow shade, right? Now this axis that I was talking about, right? Let's try to define what is this graph all about. Okay, let's try to define what is there in this graph. So if I try to define this graph, let's say hypothetically, example given, y is basically, let's say, in rupees, okay, the sales, right? In rupees, the sales of chocolates or sales of ice creams, okay? Because this is, let's say, summer season, I'm going to take this example of sales of ice cream. So this is just, let's say, the amount that I have gained or acquired, which is, let's say, also known as the revenue. Let's say this is going to be otherwise known as the revenue, okay, or the income. And you may want to change the definition of revenue also basis the use case that you can try to understand revenue. Like revenue is the total income minus the expenditure minus the taxes and so on and so forth, right? So all of those things are already applied on top of, or assumed on top of, this Y variable which we have. What we have in case of this X variable, if I'm going to do forecasting using time series, okay? So I said that time series is one of the methods by which I can do forecasting, which falls under what? Which falls under the data mining techniques, right? So if I'm going to do data mining techniques or statistical techniques, one of them, or they are being grouped together in one, let's say, category called time series to do forecasting, right? Then this x-axis, okay, is time. And it is always time. This is static. You cannot change this. You are not supposed to change this. And that is the reason why this analysis is known as time series analysis, because the independent feature, okay, or the independent variable is time. Okay, the independent variable is basically time. Because the independent variable in your data is time, that is the reason why these methods are known as time series. Right? Now, this is easy. If this is the case, then this is really easy. If this is the case, then what I can say is that I have the data. Obviously, each and every organization is going to collect some data, right? These days, everybody collects a lot of data. So I obviously will have the sales data, and I can try to model it with respect to time. And this can well become my simple regression kind of a use case, where I'm going to model it like B0 plus B1X, where X is basically time and Y is basically what I'm trying to predict. Yes, you can do that also. The answer is actually yes. It is not mandatory to use time series to solve a forecasting problem, which I just wanted to clear with this point. However, there are a few things that we have to be very, very specific about when you are going to do forecasting. So whenever you are going to do forecasting using time series, we must be very, very clear about one thing. And that one thing is as simple as, this is like the rule, or let's say, I'm going to say the must have rule. This is the must-have rule. If you don't have this rule, please don't tell me you are doing time series analysis. The must-have rule is x-axis is equidistant in terms of the data or range. What do I mean by this? Let's try to define. If, let's say, in front of you have a data set which looks something like this. Okay, let's say this is a sample data set. This is from a factory, or this is from a shop, and this shop belongs to you, and you are going to sell ice cream. Okay, you are already selling ice creams, and you simply have two or let's say three columns. So you have column one, column two, and column three. And these columns are basically, let's say you have serial number. Okay, you have serial number. On the second column, you have this X, right? This X value which you are going to put. This X value which you are going to put, which you are going to use in case of time series. And Y is the third column, which is basically the revenue or the sales of ice creams that you are having. Now, let's say you just have four entries over here. Just for the sake of simplicity, let's say this data set has only four observations. Okay. These four observations, when I say x-axis, or when I say the must-have rule is that x has to be equidistant, this means that these four entries for the value of x, right, for the value of x has to be something like this. 01 March 2021, 02 March 2021, 03 March 2021, and 04 March 2021. I don't care in which format you have written this value. Example, this value of x is here a date, okay? And obviously date is internal or intrinsically it is basically time. So time is basically, date is just a representation of time. So whether you represent it as year, month, day, or you represent it as day, month name, and short form of Y, etc. It really doesn't matter to me. I don't want to know whether you have this kind of representation or this kind of representation or anything else. But what I'm more interested in, if you look at the interval between each and every value, this is exactly the same for all the cases. And in this case, it is equal to 1 day, right? The interval is equal, right? There is an equal interval. That is what I meant over here. X-axis, by the nature of the data or the range of the data, it is equidistant, right? Now, there can be many such ways in which you can represent or start collecting the data if you would like to. Obviously, because this is an example of a shop where you are selling ice creams, it is quite logical to think that maybe at the end of the day, every day, you are going to do the bookkeeping. Okay? At the end of the day, every day, you are going to do the bookkeeping, for example, in such kind of an environment. And hence, I've used this X variable, let's say deliberately, to be dates, which are equidistant. They are distant by 1 day. And every day you will have the shop open, right? It's not that it's a Sunday, so the ice cream shop is closed. On the contrary, on a Sunday, the ice cream shop will be having more sales because people will come more. So every day you are open, okay? 365 days a year, let's say you are open. You have rotating shift-based staff in your shop, okay? You have a lot of people who are working as salesmen, okay? And they rotate with each other. You have, let's say, 10 hours or 12 working hours a day, okay? Considering all of these assumptions, right, you will have this x-axis which is going to be equidistant, right? This y value, okay, this can be represented in, let's say, rupees, or it can be represented in thousands of rupees. It can be represented in hundreds of rupees. I really don't want the scale to change. The scale has to be the same, obviously, logically, the scale, okay, of Y should be the same, or I can say it should be the same. I'm sorry, I shouldn't have zoomed out. Logically, the scale of Y should be the same for all or each value, right? This is quite understandable. This is just a logical thing, but the most important, the must-have rule is that your x-axis, which is containing date or time, where date is basically inherently represented as time, or time is inherently represented as date also, should be equidistant. Then only you can say that you have a time series data. If you don't have this, if you don't have this kind of a scenario, or if you are not going to have this kind of a use case, or you are not going to have this kind of data collection, okay? You're not going to have this kind of a data collection, then please don't tell me that you have a time series kind of a problem. You don't have a time series problem. Okay? You don't have a time series problem until and unless you tell me that this is the case. Right? I hope it is clear until this point in time. Do you have any questions?
no questions from my side.
I have one question. That suppose I don't have data for a day, like suppose the server went down or anything. So how then how will I proceed?
You
suppose
can
I don't have.
Okay.
What?
So let's say what you are saying is that let's say I'll just try to write this as an example. So example given, let's say you collected the data on 1st of March.
Can you please scroll the page up?
I did not start the sharing. Okay. So let's say you have 1st of March data, 2nd of March data, 3rd of March data. Because of some problem, on 4th of March, the server went down. Or maybe the connection did not happen over here.
Mm-hmm.
Then we have 5th of March of data. Okay. Unfortunately, in this case, the best or the ideal way, okay, the ideal way is to change the scale from 1 day to 1 week.
Okay.
To change the scale from 1 day to 1 week, which is the ideal case. Or otherwise, you may want to impute the data. If you already know which season or in which city you are, or in which kind of scenario you are, okay, basis these kind of inputs, for example, these are not the definitive list, but basis this, what you can try to do, you can try to impute. Right? For example, let's say you know that on an average per day, Rohi is going to sell 500 rupees of ice cream because it is a summer season. Okay, because it is a summer season. If that is the case, and fourth the data is missing, maybe you can simply say, okay, this value can be 500.
Okay.
So logically, you can try to impute, or you change the scale. You don't do a 1 day, you do a 1 week. So you continue collecting the data like this in your RDBMS. Let's say in your RDBMS table, okay, you still have the data collected on a day level. Try to create a view on top of it, or try to create an aggregate table on top of it. And in that table, represent the data per week. So rather than representing it on a day basis, create a new table, T2. Okay, and this is going to represent data as week 1, week 2, week 3. And in each and every row, you are going to take the average, let's say, or the sum. You can take the average or the sum value here of that entire. In that case, this interval is going to be same. You have to mandatorily keep the interval the same. The interval must be same. It must be.
Okay, I got my answer.
Yeah. If this is not the case, unfortunately, some of the methods will not work. That is the only reason why we have to keep it. Okay. Give me 1 minute. Now what we are going to do, right, is that we have understood what is my data, right? We have understood what is my data and how it has to be differentiated. Oh, by the way, one thing that I did not specifically mention, let me specifically mention that also. I hope that was quite clear from the explanation itself, but there is already, as you can see, there is an inherent order. Right, there is an inherent order in the data that I have collected. So this order is like I'm going in the ascending order or in the descending order and so on. So usually you follow the ascending order. So we must have some kind of ascending order, some kind of inherent order of this data being collected. Now when I'm talking about order, I'm going to consider both X and Y. I'm no longer considering only X. This recording of the values for columns X and column Y, this has to be in an order, right? Obviously, they have to still be equidistant from each other, the X axis, right? But there must be some order. It should not be the case that that I have just collected the data, let's say that I'm collecting the data on a monthly basis, right? So logically, it should not be the case that I've collected the data for January, then I've collected the data for February, then I stored the data for April, and later on I came back to the data of March, right? This should not be the case. There should be an inherent order. There must be an inherent order. It must be a descending order. Let that be a descending order, right? Let that be a descending order, or it can be an ascending order also. It actually depends on how we are doing the data engineering. I don't know how, or it is not really, we can't really define how we are going to do the data engineering, that the data will be in the descending order or in the ascending order. It actually depends on how we are collecting the data. For example, if I have, let's say, a lot of sensors, which are, let's say, attached to my factory, or let's say they are attached to the items in the factory, especially the electronic items. And these sensors are actually generating data that I'm capturing. Let's say these sensors are recording the temperature. Okay? If these sensors are recording the temperature, and by the way, this is not a hypothetical kind of an example. This is something which is already extensively used in the US and the UK. And they make use of very, very good computationally exclusive models. By means of which they're able to exactly estimate the kind of rain which is going to happen at a certain point in time. So this is like a real example. When we do such kind of time series analysis exercises, for example, you will be visiting sites like Quandl. Okay, for example, this is a very, very nice site where a lot of time series data is by default available. This covers use cases like sensor. Okay, it covers use cases like stocks. It covers use cases like sales and so on. So these are like the examples, you can say, where the data is collected in order, right? And they are equidistant to each other, right? Now, in this example where these factory items are generating some sensor data, right? This data may well be getting stored in the descending order, in the ascending order, depending on what kind of data engineering I'm using. But the order, when I'm going to use this data D, to apply the methods, okay? When I'm going to apply the methods, then the order has to be the same, right? I have to follow a equivocal order, okay? Now, keeping this in mind, as we have understood the basics, let's try to understand how really we are going to do time series analysis, right? How really we are going to do the time series analysis. Now, before we even go in there, I would like to quickly tell you a disclaimer. Okay? I would like to quickly tell you a disclaimer. First of all, or initially, or maybe for the majority of the sections, what I would like to concentrate on is also known as univariate time series analysis. Okay, I'll concentrate mostly on univariate time series analysis because this is not only the most interesting, okay, it is also the most common. Right? That is not to say that we cannot have bivariate. Okay? That is not to say that we cannot have bivariate use cases. Now, what do I mean by that? What I mean by this is that if I have univariate cases, then I simply have X and Y. And I need to find a function. Okay? I need to find some kind of a function which is going to model Y in terms of X. So X is time and Y is some kind of outcome. I'm going to model the outcome with respect to time using this function. This is known as univariate because my independent variable is single. What if I have two different independent variables, x1, x2, right? This can also be a time series where one of them is time, let's say. One of them is date and time. Other one is something else, right? Other one is something else. And then we have y, right? This is quite a real use case. This is quite a real case, okay? Right? But many of our common use cases can be modeled in terms of univariate analysis. What are those? For example, the sensors which are capturing, let's say, the temperature data. Then let's say the stock prices. Okay. Then let's say I'm going to take that ice cream sales kind of a data, right? Then I'm going to take data sets which are equal to, let's say, the data sets which will be similar to profits. Then there will be refunds which are asked by the customers in Flipkart, right? Then there will be demand of product. Okay, so how many products has to be produced in my factory so that, you know, I can meet the demands, right? So if you look at every of these examples, they can be very, very simply modeled, okay? Or they can be represented or stored in form of X, Y, right? They can be stored in form of X, Y. That's the reason why, because most of the common and interesting use cases can anyways be modeled as univariate time series data. That's the reason why we're going to concentrate mostly on univariate, but I'm going to give you the resources so that you can later on learn about the multivariate time series analysis also, right? Now let's look into what is the actual or how we are going to study the time series, okay, how we are going to study the time series. Obviously, this is where a lot of exploration, okay, a lot of exploration will be required, okay, a lot of exploration of the data will be required. But let's try to understand something before we even go in there, right? The first thing we need to understand, usually, as I have told you, the first thing which I have also told you, that let's say if you have some historical data which is looking something like this, you may get a prediction which looks only something like this. Usually that is the case. If your model is really powerful, it may do something even better also, where X is time and Y is some variable you are trying to, you know, forecast. If your model is really powerful, it may go beyond this section also, right? It may extend here also. So if it extends, then I can try to divide it into 2 to 3 parts, right? I can call this forecast that I have created as long term, medium term, and short term. Okay? This is quite easy to understand, but this is something that I have to keep in mind, because this is going to determine, okay, the method that we are going to use, right? The complexity increases like this, or the complexity decreases like this. The complexity of your model is going to decrease like this. If you have a long-term kind of a futuristic forecasting which you need to do, for example, I have to do a forecasting of the next 5 to 10 years. I have to predict, I have to forecast what is going to be my ice cream sales for the next 10 years, right? This is a big use case. This is where, or these are cases where, you know, people are going to do, or they're going to use this kind of data for strategic decision making. Yeah, they're going to use this data for strategic decision making. Let's say in our organization also, the management who are almost at the top, they create plans which is for the next 3 years, 5 years, and 10 years and so on. If they're creating any plans for the next 5 years, they must have ample data which is helping them to forecast, which is helping them to estimate what is going to happen, or what they should expect from the organization, from the employees, from the deliverables, from the infrastructure for the next 5 years. So they are able to do that kind of forecasting because obviously they will have some data and they will have powerful methods to do it, right? But usually what we do is something which is known as medium term, which is like 2 to 5 years, right? This is like the medium term kind of a thing. Right, this is almost applicable to 2 to 5 years of data. For example, the use cases where we would use this is something like hiring. Right, the use cases where we are going to use this is something known as hiring. So maybe in the hiring area, usually in the hiring area, this is what we are going to use. Right, however, one thing to note over here is that the longer the term is, the question that comes over my model is the reliability, right? The question that is raised over the model is the reliability. If it is a medium term kind of a forecast, right? If it is a medium term kind of forecast, obviously I can do alterations, right? I can do alterations. For example, let's say I have a 2 year forecast right now. So this is what? This is March 2021, and I have a forecast until March 2023. Obviously, there is no hard and fast rule that I have to follow this entire forecast for the next 2 years, okay? I can try to change it in the between. Let's say by the time it is March 2022, yes, and I expect that the pandemic will be over by then, I may be able to alter it. I may be able to revisit, okay? I may be able to revisit what I have already done, right? So this kind of revisiting can be done in case of the medium-sized use case, but it will be very costly, right? It will be very costly for me to do if I have a long-term, if I have a long-term kind of a forecasting requirement, right? So usually for long-term kind of forecasting requirement, the reliability is always a question. It is almost, let's say, more generalized. It is never really specific, right? So the complexity as well as the specificity, okay, of the models is going to decrease like this. Or it is going to decrease like this. The specificity is going to increase like this, I can say, right? So it will be lowest here and highest for the short term thing. So for the short term things, which is an example, which is over here, as you can see, the term here is really very, very short. For example, let me try to define what I mean by this short. Let's say this is X1, this is X2, and this is X3, right? This data that I have taken is usually that of the last 5 years, for example. And what I will be able to predict is maybe for the next 2 weeks, right? This is kind of a general model. I will be able to predict something for the next 4 weeks. These are outcomes from any general kind of models. And this is what we should expect. This is what we should expect from any general model. Okay, any kind of general modeling technique that we are going to look into, the names of a few can include, let's say, exponential smoothing. Then we are going to look into auto regression, moving average, auto regressive moving average, auto regressive integrated moving average, something known as SARIMA also. So these are the methods which we are going to learn. Okay, these are the methods that we are going to learn during the course of time. Each and every one of them have their advantages and the disadvantages. So, but these are mostly the general cases. And these are applicable both for short and the medium time span. They are really not applicable for the longer time span. If you need longer time span, you need, let's say, methods which can handle big data. Okay, handle big data plus estimate. Okay, with increased reliability, right? It can estimate with increased, let's say, reliability, right? These we are going to look into later on, but most of the use cases that we will look over here is going to be medium, which is like 2 to 5 years, or it can be short term, right? So the short term can include something like 2 weeks to, let's say, 6 months, right? 2 weeks to 6 months, I can say it is going to be short term, right? What kind of use cases can be over here? Example given, the rostering. If I'm creating some kind of a roster for my organization, obviously this is like a work from home kind of a scenario, but you can try to understand rostering is going to be applicable for, let's say, the operational support teams who are going to work in the out of office or something, especially in the IT industry. So there will be teams who are looking into the support kind of work. They are working in the support kind of work, and they will be doing out of office kind of work also, or they will be into on-call kind of a support also after the office hours or during the weekends and so on and so forth, where the customers or the front desk is going to call them, report them about issues, and they'll have to solve it, right? So for that kind of a rostering, if I would like to do the planning for the rostering as to let's say these many number of incidents are there per week, and this is the way it is increasing or decreasing, how can I model that data and try to find out how many people I need for the on-call support, right? How many people am I going to need in case of the on-call support? So these are the cases which can be applicable for the short-term cases, right? Usually the sales cases are usually what we look into for the short-term or the medium-term cases. The refunds are also a good example for short and the medium-term cases, right? And so on, right? So these are the use cases. You can say, these are basically, I can say, the use cases. Basis the duration, right? So basis the duration of the forecasting, this is going to be the use case. Any doubts until this point in time? No.
One thing that... So I cannot do daily forecasting, like if yes. There is, I can do this.
You can do daily forecasting. So if you are talking about, let's say, small scale forecasting, right? If you're talking about mm-hmm. small scale, then here, let's say you have the next 2 weeks of data. So in the next 2 weeks of data, daily, okay, daily, you mm-hmm. can rerun your model and you will be getting the outcome for the next day. Right, daily you will be able to do the forecasting. Daily you will be able to run your model, and for the next day you will get the value. Yes.
Okay.
That is going to fall under your short-term kind of a thing, right? Because you already have a defined period of, let's say, 2 weeks to 4 weeks or to 6 months and so on. And inside that, the next day is going to fall. So, for example, I have created a model which I have trained as of today. Let's say today is what, 18th of March, right? The 18th of March 2021, I created my model, okay, which is the version one of the model, and I am able to predict for the next 15 days, let's say. Okay, so for each of the next 15 days, I'm able to predict, which means I'm able to estimate for 19th, 28th, 21st, 22nd, and so on. Right? Again, on the 19th of March 2021, I'm again going to run this model M1. I'm going to call this version V2, let's say. I'm going to retrain this model with a newer set of delta data. I will tell you how this is done. This is known as model retraining. Okay, this is known as model retraining. We often do this in case of, let's say, machine learning also, but it is equally applicable for the data mining techniques as well, right? So on the 19th, this is my use case. Maybe that is what your use case is. So every day you will retrain the model M1, and then again, you are going to estimate the values for the next 15 days. So obviously, when you are going to retrain the model on 19th, you can estimate the value for 20th.
Okay.
Right. Okay. Before we move on, I would suggest that we can make a stop here for today. What we would have to learn now is that in the next class, the next item that we will need to learn are the components. Okay. We need to know about the components of a time series. Okay. How we can break down the components of a time series. What they really mean for us, are they really going to be useful for us or not, right? And then which components we are going to keep and which components we are going to reject. In other words, which component we are going to be most interested into and the ones which we are not going to be interested in. Once we are done with this, then we will start looking into the modeling tech. Okay? Then we'll start looking at the modeling side of it. Right, I'll do one thing. I'll take an export of this as a image PNG file, and let me just save this, and then I'm going to share it with you. So this is like what, today's 129, 19 March. No, this is 18th March, right? 18th March time series. Okay, I think that's all from my side, friends, as of now. Let's continue same time from tomorrow.
Sure.
Okay. Thank you, Rohit. Thank you, Shashwat.
Thanks, Mom. Good night.
Thank you.
Good night.